I'm Klaas Martens. Our farm is near Penn, New York. We're on the slope of Seneca Lake and the land of the Seneca, the Native Americans who farmed here before we did. We farm just under 2,000 acres. We've been organic since the early 1990s, and we grow about anything that'll grow in New York. We probably have 25 to 30 crops in any given year. A lot of diversity, heavily centered on grains and legumes, but also some vegetable crops. My approach to weed management has turned 180 degrees since I first started. And I had to unlearn a lot of things. The best way I can encapsulate it is that when you have a field, it's an ecosystem. And if you can manage it in such a way that the crop that you're growing that year is the best adapted species to that environment, it will give that crop a biological advantage over every other species, which would help the crop beat the weeds out. And it extends to other things, not just weeds. It would extend to disease. It would extend to fungi, insect problems. You know, all of those things can be looked at in the same way. That was really a tough turn to make when I'd been taught and thought all my life the other way around, that these things are random that we react to. So this farm has the same weeds everyone else does. It's a matter of degree and distribution. So when I have them, some of the worst ones are pigweed, Palmer amaranth, lamb's quarter, velvet leaf. They tend to grow where the fertility is high. They tend to grow in disturbed locations, which is agriculture. And if they're not controlled, they are extremely competitive to crops and they can really lower yield. Now that said, our farming system has been successful in managing them so that they're not a major threat. We can say that they're our worst weeds, but they don't actually have to hurt our crops. They don't actually have to lower our yields. What I'm finding now is when I have a weed flush get by me, it's usually like an F on a report card. It's a place where I made a mistake or I did something or I tried to get away with something that nature called me on. So a key principle in controlling weeds is to not give them the same environment every year. What I used to do when I was farming conventionally with herbicides, I was actually selecting for the species that were going to be the biggest problem. Because I would give the same environment, exactly the same environment, year after year, and any weed that made seed was being grown in the same environment the next year so that those seeds were better adapted to start with. So that if you have a lot of spring annual weeds, winter grains are not likely to have a weed problem because they grow in a totally different life cycle than your pest does. So mismatching the life cycle of your crop with the life cycle of the weeds is a big one. Now, when we have an intractable pest problem, be it a weed or a disease or an insect, almost every time if you can add one new species to the system and if it's the right one, adding that level of diversity, adding the right diversity at the right part of the system will change the environment so that that pest is not the best adapted species at that point of your system anymore. What I've found is observation is really important. So when I go out there, first of all, I enjoy looking at my fields, which makes it a lot easier for me to go out and actually notice what's going on. But it's an early warning system. Nature actually gives us an early warning system. And when we start seeing little changes, if we can notice them, they make us look for other things. My advice would be the first thing is to go out and try to notice the anomaly. Try to notice something that's different. Just clear your mind and look at the field and see what jumps out at you. And it really helps to identify weed species. And also talk to other farmers about it, because the things that I've noticed that I've learned the hard way, I've passed on to farmers who already had made the observations once it was brought to their attention, and it gave them kind of a head start. The first one and easiest one is to observe the rotation effect. Certain crops always do better after certain other predecessors. It sounds really good to say that when the crop is the best adapted species for the environment, that everything goes well, but the question is, how do we get there? And I found that when we design rotations, we've got a problem. We go forward in time but we really need to design a rotation backward in time. Where would I like to plant my corn? And the answer for me has generally been after medium red clover. Well, what do I have to do to have medium red clover there at the time when I want to get ready to plant corn? Well, the answer to that could be medium red clover does really well if I cross seed it into a winter grain. So then now we go backwards, say wheat or spelt. I found I get better clover in spelt than I do in wheat because if the wheat yields high, it can suppress the clover. Those are all in the details. So now, what environment will wheat do well in? And wheat does really well after summer vegetables. It also does really well after oats. It can do well after soybeans if it's planted early enough. It can do well after crops like peas. So we've got a group of crops that work there. So now what environment will favor them? So that's just giving a framework for thinking through it. We don't have a typical crop rotation because it's based on principles, but there are some things that work really well everywhere for us. A typical rotation that we started with way back would have been corn, soybeans, wheat, or corn, soybeans, spelt, clover, underseeded. And then we expanded it and went from wheat to winter barley to another winter grain, and then back to the corn and soybeans. But since then, we've found markets for so many different crops, and we've been able to indulge in much more diverse rotations. So in designing a rotation and managing fields, there is always a tension between what's convenient and efficient for the machinery and for the machinery operators, what makes good use of the labor force on the farm, and what is going to be optimum for the nature, for the biology, and for the needs of the soil. So what we've learned is to try to avoid having individual fields that need to be treated completely different from everything around them, because it is just a problem. If you have to bring a combine in for just one field and we're spread out over many miles, it can take a lot of time, it can cost a lot of money. At the same time though, if we just plant the crop that would be convenient for us to plant and it's not good for the soil, it's a major loss if you have a bad crop just because of deficiency. If nothing else, I've found that whenever you have more, a field that's too wide, we tend to have pest issues because you just don't have the balance you get from the other species that are nearby. And we give up a small amount of efficiency and we gain a huge amount of biological benefit. I read once that if you do what you love, you never work a day in your life, and I've never worked a day in my life. Farming is just what I love to do, and to me it's fun. There's a lot of variety. We don't get bored, unless we're trying to.